please come in, have a seat, so that we can start our second part of the morning session. My name is Anna Wienhardt. I'm a professor here at Heidelberg University and a member of the scientific committee. And it's a great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Ngô Bảo Châu from the University of Chicago. As, I mean, all our laureates, of course, he won the Fields Medal as he has won several other awards. I think he has something which is very untypical even among the Fields Medalists. So his proof of the fundamental lemma made it into the Time magazine's 10 discoveries of the year in 2009, the year before he was awarded the Fields Medal. And I remember being at lunch at the Institute for Advanced Study when Peter Sarnak, a permanent member in the School of Mathematics, came to the lunch table very excited because he had just received a call from the Time magazine asking him what he would think of being very important discoveries in mathematics. And he said, well, he told them about the fundamental lemma, and he really hopes that it will make it into the Time magazine. And so it was number 7 of the 10 discoveries of the year of 2009. And I think the fundamental lemma, of course, fascinated people in mathematics, but apparently also outside of mathematics. And today, Ngô Bảo Châu will give us another introduction and talk about another fascinating topic, the Riemann zeta function and its generalization. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It's a real pleasure and honor for me to be back here and to give this talk on Riemann zeta functions. I'm not going to talk about fundamental lemma, although at some point I say what way it can be used for at some point in my talk. So my talk about these Riemann zeta functions. Riemann wrote one single paper in number theory, but that is probably the paper who had the deepest influence in the whole development of this theory. And I try to convey a sense why number theories are so intricated by this quite very fascinating object that is Riemann zeta functions. But let's step back a little bit into the history. This question that has been addressed as early as the Greek times in Euclid. Euclid made this extraordinary proof that there are infinite many prime numbers that I guess all of you know by contradictions, right? I'm not going to repeat that proof. Rather, I try to explain in a non-rigorous way another proof that due to Euler, that is somehow less known. So Euler considered this series, you know, a sum of n to the minus s, right, as a function of the real variable in s. Of course, this series only converges for real numbers of s greater than 1. It diverges, the harmonic series diverges. But what's really interesting is it had these factorizations, right? On the left-hand side is a series, on the right-hand side is infinite product over the prime numbers. You have this expression because of the unique factorization of integers. Every integer can be factorized in a unique way as product primes. And that fundamental property of arithmetics can be encapsulated in these single identities. So it can analytic expression of that fundamental theorem arithmetics. So of course this both side makes sense only for s greater than 1, right? But now and look at what happened at s equal to 1, right? On the left-hand side, you get the divergent series. And the right-hand side, it will be convergent if the set of prime numbers is finite, right? Every single factor is, you know, have no pawn that s equal to 1. So it has only finite product, then there will be a problem. So that was the observation of Euler, Right? So the so that is all the proof. So that is some of this long this series. So this is zeta functions. It's really zeta functions. But Riemann, instead of consider the function of real variables, Riemann consider this as the function of complex variables. And this actually bring in a huge change of landscape. So now you have this this series, these functions, it converges if the real part of S is greater than one, right? And of course, this can be proven easily that it is absolutely convergent, uniformly on compact time, and so on. So this series, this whole series, converge to very nice functions, holomorphic functions, on the domain of real part of S greater than one. And moreover, the Euler arguments applies. That means these zeta functions on this domain have this factorization in product of factors, right? Indexed by prime numbers. So this argument of Euler's extends to the complex domain. And so what the Riemann is, he proved that these functions now can be extended on the whole domain of whole complex plane, but it catch pawns at S1 to 1, so the only single pawn at S1 to 1, and in that way he can make sense of these kind of funny identities. When you put S1 to 0, so of course this doesn't make sense, this is 1 plus 1 plus 1, but then if you compute the value of this function, it now completely defined, and you get zeta of 0, you can 1 minus 1/2. And some sense, 1 plus 1 plus 1 is -1/2 in Riemann sense. And it puts, you can add on to -1 is even more funny. So 1 plus 2 plus 3 would be -1/12. So that is, anyway. So these papers have had a huge influence in number theory because it set a way into understand what's called prime number theorem. So how many are there primes lesser than a given magnitude? That is the title of the Riemann memoir. So the argument goes as follows. Here you have zeta. Zeta is a product over primes. If you take a logarithmic derivative, right, and then product becomes a sum. So you get, this is a logarithmic derivative of zeta, and you can develop into a sum. What happened is, it's almost a sum over prime numbers, right? So this is lambda n is called von Markov functions. Lambda n is going to log p if n is a power of a prime number. Prime numbers. So if lambda of 6 is 0, for example. So basically, it, when you take a logarithmic derivative, written it as a series, you only get, only left the coefficient corresponding to prime numbers. So this is actually the sum of the primes. So if you denote pi x, the number of prime less than a given real number x, then the prime number theorem that was actually already suspected, I mean, hypothesized by Gauss and Legendre by numerical calculations, that pi x should be equivalent to x over log x as x equal to infinity. And pi x is basically a sum of 1 plus 1 over the set of prime numbers, right? Now, because there's not so much difference between the prime and the set of power primes, it's quite elementary to prove it, to prove that this, the prime number theorem is equivalent to this. So instead of counting prime, we just sum the von Markov function up to n less than given x. And it's equal to say this sum is equivalent to x when x goes to infinities. So this is quite some argument, but not, you know, and not to torture you with those arguments, but it's very elementary. Now we see the relation between the prime number theorem with the von Magnus functions and with the logarithmic derivative delta functions, right? So this is the, when you look at the logarithmic derivative as the series, you get this lambda n as coefficient of directly series. And now the question is how to estimate this sum of lambda n. Okay, so now we come a little bit of harmonic analysis. So let's look at the discombination on the Euclidean series. I mean, just sum of n to the s with coefficient some given function. It can be von Magnus function, it can be anything. And with some, now you really see why it have to look at s as complex parameters, because you can use complex integrations. Instead of have only real and lie, you can integrate your vertical lies. And so now if you get this function, you integrate it over some vertical lie. Now so let's assume that this series converges absolutely, right? When S, when a real property of S greater than sigma zero, some number, so we have nice convergent series on some half planes. And on that half plane, you can estimate this sum, right? An, this partial sum. An n less than x by this Cauchy integrals of vertical lies, right? So it looks a little bit complicated, you know, I don't know how it helps, but the very basic things, you know, if you only care about x, so the only occurrence of x is actually the s, right? So if you ignore all the difficulties, but other difficulties, you would say that this is basically actually the s, because that is the only thing that counts, right? So you have estimate. You can estimate the sum on the left by some constant time h to the sigma. So that's the, you know, very roughly the basic information you can get from this complex integration. But now this should not depend on sigma, right? Because you get better estimate by moving your lie integration. You know, as long as the lie integration is still contained in the convergence domain, there's no difference doing that, and you can move into integration on the way where you get some points, right? Right. So, I mean, you get some points, I mean, in complex analysis, it's not a problem, just move across the pole and you catch the residues, right? And just doing so by this trick of, this very basic tricking at number theory, just moving the live integration further to the left as much as you can, right? And that you can get some kind of asymptotic expression of this sum, right? The main terms would be the residues that you catch along the way moving your live integrations, right? And you can do it as much as you can analytically continue your complex function. So that's why it's very important to get the meromorphic continuation of the delta function, right? And when you get it, you can also meromorphic continue with logarithmic derivative and so on. Okay, so now we want to understand this, to apply this trick, this complex integration to this, the logarithmic derivative of zeta, right? And so we need to understand, you know, anyone, then you say the lambda 1 plus lambda 2 plus et cetera plus lambda n can be estimated by the points of the logarithmic derivative of zeta. But the pawn of this is just exactly the pawns and the zeros of zeta. So that is why you really need to, zeta doesn't have to have one pawn, it's very simple, just pull at one. So what really count as zero of zeta functions? So that's why it's such a big deal to understand zero of zeta functions. So for example, by following these basic strategies, Adamar and de la Vallée-Poussin prove, I mean, rigorously, at the, you know, the beginning of 20th centuries, that there is some, you can extend slightly over the Lie real property of S going to 1, right? So have some kind of zero free zone. It, you know, it gets closer and closer to 1 when the imaginary part gets to infinities, but it's really the open part. Right, And just with this, they can prove the pi number theorem. Yes, lambda 1 plus lambda 2 plus lambda n is equivalent to n. But of course, the Riemann condition is much stronger. He thinks that the zeros are all in the on the critical lie of Riemann property of f1.5. And somehow the estimate can never go past that lie. And that is the best you can do, is just go closer to S, Riemann property of s1.5. Okay. So that I try to say in very unrigorous way, ideas in Riemann papers and the development further. Of course, there's a lot of difficulties. I ignore on the possible difficulties in doing this, you know, inverse Fourier transform and so on. But now let's, one of the, I think very remarkable is this story just doesn't apply only to Riemann data functions, but to many similar functions. So one of the basic examples that come almost the same time as Riemann is this Kondiwecker L functions. So it's very similar, but we have some more data. So you start with some n conductors is natural numbers, right? And you are given the characters of the multiplicative group, z mod n z c star. So let's pick an example, n into 3. And so only have one, two class, that is, the, so z mod 3 has three classes, modulo 3. And the cross just delete this zero. So the characters can pick one when n is congruent to one modulo 3, and minus one when n is congruent to two modulo 3, right? And so form this function on the class from the modulo n, you can just extend it to z by just putting zero where the function is not defined earlier. And then you can just form this series. So it's completely similar to the Riemann data functions, but instead of one, you put one or minus one, or you know, or unit roots, depending on your characters. And of course, there is if n if here big n equal to 3, then there's no more term with n equal to 3, so term is just left out. And very similar to Riemann data function, you can prove this function have meromorphic continuation, and actually it's more quite more amazing. It have no bonds if the chi is not trivial in characters. It has no bonds, and that is how directly prove that there is infinite primes in arithmetic progressions. So that is you know, you can count the number of prime in arithmetic progressions by the same kind of tricks, you know, and just apply the Perron, this called the Perron formula, to this directly L functions, and get into that. So there's no, and moreover, this one have no bonds, and it's even easier. And also, it is this L function supposed to satisfy Riemann hypothesis also on this. Interesting zeros must be on the lie of Riemann property of s1.5, but of course nobody have a single clue how it's true. Okay. Now let me move on further. So as in as was emphasized in S. Andrew White lectures, you know, number theory had to move at some point from abelian to non-abelian. And here the break point is the theory of L Hecker theory of L function attached modular forms. So I mean, I haven't studied enough of history to know, but I guess this that it was not clear why it is connected to Riemann data function, although we have many similar properties. So he start with modular forms. Modular form is essentially some kind of holomorphic function on the half plane, right? And this satisfies a modular relation. So like AZ plus B over CZ plus D is, it doesn't change the function up to some factors, the modular factors. C, so this K is the width, between the width of the modular forms. And this function, this equality is supposed to be satisfied for all 2x2 matrix, ABCD, that is integral matrix. So, or ABCD belongs to some discrete subgroup of SN2R. Right? So that is modular forms. Of course, there's more growth conditions, so on, but I don't want to bother you with that. And so assume that this gamma is the full modular group, SN2 of Z, right? And then just apply matrix 1, 1, 1, and C, 1, 2, 0. You get you get F of Z plus 1 has to be equal to F of Z, right? So this one has to be periodic when you move 1 to the left, to the right. And because periodic, you can apply full, it has some kind of full expansion. So F of Z has to be of this form, AN exponential 2. So you know, this is clearly invariant when you add 1 to Z, right? It doesn't change. And because of that, you have this series function had to have these forms. And it should declare that you look at AN as interesting arithmetic information and put all of them into some Dirichlet series, AN and to the minus S. So it's not very clear at the first sight why you should do that. You know, but what Hecker proved is that this function, this has very much the same properties as the Riemann zeta functions. That means it have meromorphic continuations and so on. Maybe have born or no born depending on the form is cuspid or not. But so now let me move into some further properties of on this zeta function and L functions. So what is very important in the singled out by Riemann himself is not only the zeta functions have meromorphic continuation, but have some kind of symmetries, very remarkable symmetries. So in the case of zeta function, you have to add some kind of mysterious factors, you know, this kind of gamma factors. You add gamma, the usual gamma functions, and there's some funny numbers, some expression. And then this C function is symmetrical by 1/2. So this is why this lie 1/2 is so important, because that is symmetric arc of the, and this have C of S equal to C of 1 minus S. So it was easier for me to explain why meromorphic continuation was important because you want to prove pi number theorem. But now it's more difficult to explain why functional equation is important. But it is really the same package and it's important. And what happened is on other examples, the Dirichlet L functions and Hecker L functions attached to modular forms, satisfy the same kind of properties. That means you can have meromorphic continuations. And if you add some funny factors, then it has some kind of same symmetries. Like the L function, the Dirichlet L function satisfy exactly the same equations with some gamma factors, but also some factors depending on some pi p, because you know in the Dirichlet, so you have some prime P that divide the conductors. So you need to add in some factors that depending on those prime P, as well as gamma factors at infinities. In the case of the of modular forms, you only need to add some gamma factors at infinities, but also on some factors depending on the primes, depending on your group gamma, right? So each gamma is SN2Z, you don't need to add anything at finite primes, but if gamma is smaller, then you need to add some things. And it, at that stage, it's very confusing what you need to add. You know, it's like a case by case, you need to add something so that you have functional equations. So I think the real progress was achieved in the introduction of addends and set out by in in the data list in the 1950s. And so what TED does is, so this come by this notion of very, it's quite bizarre looking notion of addends. So addends was invented before by, first by Chevalier and then by Acton, in context of class field theory. So when you start with a field of rational numbers, you have different kind of completions, right? You can do analysis, you need to complete. So you can complete Q by the usual norms and then get to your numbers. And if you complete Q by it's called the periodic norms, it depends how, you know, not close in the Newton sense, but close in the sense they're different, is divisible by high power P. And then you complete that way, you get some good periodic numbers. And what happened is you can prove that those are the only possible way to complete rational numbers in some sensible way. And the addend is some guy just put, I forgot some comma here. You know, basically you have to multiply all of them, so put on these big things together. But here I missed a comma. Because if I don't, this is, you cannot do analysis with this, because it's not locally compact. If you put a comma in the restrict product, then it's locally compact, and then you can do punctuation duality, you can do Fourier analysis. So even this look very big, but it's still amenable to do Fourier analysis on this. And what Ted does is he proved that on this construction of Riemann delta function, also DKL function, that seem to come out from analysis, some numbers can be put entirely in the framework of Fourier analysis. So all these functions are just some kind of intrinsic function that you would see when you do Fourier analysis, both on R, on QP, and also on the whole things, on the addends. And so that is why, so first of all, on these factors, 1 minus P minus S minus 1 comes out when you do Fourier and Mellin transform on the periodic numbers. And because you miss, in doing so, you miss the real numbers. If you do the same process over the real numbers, you do get these factors. So you get these bizarre-looking factors just by applying the same recipe instead of periodic over the real numbers, right? So these whole things is actually some kind of structure of Fourier analysis over the addends. And then the functional equations come out on Poisson summation formula, and I'm not going to say what it is, but when you have locally compact groups and you have some discrete co-compact subgroups, right? It is a fact that Q is locally compact subgroup of A. So in, the way you understand this is you would say that A is some kind of enriched version of R, and Q is enriched version of Z. And so Q inside A is very much like R inside Z, right? So Z is discrete and co-compact subgroup of R. So as Q is discrete co-compact subgroup of A. And you can make it much, much more precise. You can see that A mod Q is actually some kind of universal covering of the circle. Right? So that is one of the best ways to understand addends. You look at the circles and look at the universal covering, pro covering of the circles, and that will be A over Q. So you do Fourier analysis on R and on QP, and do Mellin transform, that means you do it on the multiplicative groups, and discrepancy, apply So you start with a function, some class of functions. So you can do, apply the Mellin transform to one side, and apply Fourier transform, apply Mellin transform on another side. And the, you have a ratio. And that ratio does depend on the choice of test function. The ratio is always the same. And that is the local factors of the of Riemann zeta function and the HLF functions. And when you that's called the kind of small gamma functions, and because of the Poisson summation formula, when you multiply on this local factor, you get one. And that is equivalent to the Poisson summation formula. So that is to say that on this function that seem to, you know, that you, that Riemann construct Euler to address some specific problem in number theory have complete intrinsic existence in Fourier theory. Okay, it's just term of Fourier theory. Okay. And now the, what happened is the, now it, the Hecker story of L function of modular forms also can be completely put into this vision somehow. So just move from, instead of GN1, you move to GN2. And that is would give you the theory of Hecker. So that was Jacques and Lenlen did 1974 in their book. So they just, you know, review the whole Hecker theory as automorphic L function attached automorphic forms over GN2 of the addends. So now, I mean, I cannot explain what it is because it goes very far off from the from usual knowledge of mathematics, but it is. And earlier in 1969, 70, Langland envisioned the whole story, how it should work. So it actually, the automorphic form should be attached to some reductive groups. So reductive groups, as you know, the usual group that you know, GN Len, SN Len, orthogonal symplectic group, and so on. There's a couple of other exceptional groups. And you would get an L function by two data. One is automorphic for the representation of G, and the other data is some kind of finite dimensional representation of LG. And LG is the Condon groups. That also sometimes appears in physics, but in the context it appears in representations of Lie groups. And Langlands define this L function in the same ways as Riemann. That means you just look at the local factors, like this 1 to the p minus s to the minus 1. You can have the similar local factors for any pi and for any rho, and just multiply them up together. And he can prove that it does converge on some right half plane. And so the whole question is why this function that is well-defined, holomorphic and right half plane can be meromorphically continued and have some functional equations. And there's very important known case due to Godman-Jacquet, that is case of G going to GN Len, right? And GN Len and then the Duan Gubi GN itself, it has standard representations. And that's called Godman-Jacquet. And Godman-Jacquet theory is real. I mean, it's not straightforward, but it's a direct generalization of tet series. So you use very much the same technique as tet series. And they do Fourier transform on the space of matrices and so on. And so, one is the main goal in theory of automorphic form to prove you can functoriate conjectures. It just can be in some kind of a poor man version, you can say that these on automorphic L functions are the standard L functions. So those functions that is defined by Godman-Jacquet are standard L functions because the rho is standard representations. And Langlands conjecture that is on automorphic L functions should be the same as, exactly the same as standard L functions. So that means that you can have possibly a transfers of automorphic form on G to automorphic form on G and Len, so that it keeps the same L functions. So that is the content of you know, the one of the big thrust in theory automorphic forms, and so that one of the things that I have been working on. So this, in some case, on endoscopic case, you can do this. This whole transfer problem is actually quite almost done. It's done, and the fundamental lemma is a part of it. And now we, people in the field work on the further case, in the, when the transfer is no longer on endoscopic, but in, so. So I mean, so we are trying to, in particular, try to generalize this method Goldman-Jacquet from standard into any automorphic representation. Maybe it's quite challenging, but it maybe it's doable. Okay, so so that is one of the facets of Langlands conjecture, that you have automorphic form on reductive groups and have regional notion of L functions, and the basic conjecture is the functoriality conjecture that you don't get more. It just the standard L functions are on the L function you can get. And so the other facet is called the reciprocity conjectures. So that I that's kind of alpha that come from completely different aspect of mathematics when has zeta functions. So when you have algebraic varieties divided with number of fins, any set of equations, polynomial equations, you can set algebraic varieties, and you count number of points of the algebraic varieties, or count number of solutions, modulo p for different p, and you get some numbers, and put them, these those numbers in some consistent way, and make the Euler product that gives you called Hassel zeta functions. And the Hassel zeta function is supposed to have the same properties as the Riemann zeta function. But because Langlands, I mean, at least in his philosophy, say that the on the L function you get automorphic L functions. So that means these on these L functions have to be connect to some automorphic form in some way, right? In pieces of the L function. And that is somehow the only way you can prove that Hassel zeta function can be meromorphic continue and have functional equations, right? So there's one, of course, a very famous case is known is for the elliptic curve. That means just one single cubic equation and car number of points on the elliptic curve. And then you can write down what is a Hassel zeta function elliptic curve. And that had to be the L function attached to a modular form of weight 2. And that is a huge achievement of Sir Andrew Wise and his collaborators. And that is that elliptic curve of a Q. That is a known story now. And but, you know, what we hope, respect, it's much larger. It's not just elliptic curve, not just cubic equation, but any set of equations should have the same properties. But we are, I think, way off from that goal, right? So now you see the two different facets of the story. One facet is very much more harmonic analysis, you know, on Lie groups, so the structures of reductive group and harmonic analysis on periodic group and real group and complex groups, and but that is kind of, not so much connected to number theory, properly speaking. But that give you what the L functions should be. You know that how you construct the whole of them and how they are they depend from, you know, what the relation between L functions should be encoded in entirely in the theory of automorphic forms. And the application to number theory should go through the reciprocity conjecture. I mean, you have set of definite equations and you have Riemann zeta functions, Hassel zeta functions, and they have to be by reciprocity conjecture connected to some automorphic L function, right? But then to some standard L function. So you would say that the two conjectures somehow quite independent, right? Because after all, we only care about, you can, you know, if you are number theorist, you can only care about the standard L functions, because you know, a posteriori you know that all L functions should be standard L functions. But in practice, it never goes that way. You know, when you prove reciprocity conjecture, you need to bring the two conjectures together. You know, you have jump from one group to other to, you know, to prove some kind of reciprocity conjectures. So in doing number theory now, they really have to very much to grasp what you can do in deformation, periodic deformation theory in one side, and the known case in functoriality other side, and Shimura variety can combine together and get more and more result on the way, because nothing is known in complete generalities. Okay, that is the content of my talk. I hope give you some sense about what this generalized zeta function is. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your very interesting and I think also a bit challenging talk. To understand, I would like to ask for questions from the audience. Are there questions? So, yeah? I give you the microphone.
You mentioned that the fundamental lemma somewhere appears. Where does it appear?
It appears here in functoriality conjectures. It appears in proving some kind of functoriality conjectures. And it should be used to prove, to go further. Yes. So for example, you can transfer automorphic from SO2N to GN2N, for example, or S in some, so on, it appears. Was used by Jim Arthur to prove all automorphic forms on classical group can be transferred to GN land. But for the functoriorities need, somehow it's for some kind of very small row, for a row like you know, the embedding of SO2N to GN2N, for example. But if you do some kind of very big representation like a symmetric to the power 100, then fundamental lemma is not enough. But it's supposed to be still firm ground to build something upon to go to the marginal case.
So reciprocity in algebraic number theory usually has a different connotation, right? So does that have anything to do with the nomenclature here for reciprocity conjecture?
Sorry?
Reciprocity, usually when you talk about reciprocity in algebraic number theory, it's related to splitting of primes in algebraic number fields and so on. And here you have, this is also called reciprocity conjecture. Is it just an accident that the reciprocity is used?
I think it's the same reciprocity.
It is? So
it is, yeah.
How so is it the same reciprocity?
For example, in the case of quadratic reciprocity, right, you have quadratic extension of Q, right? And then you look at when the prime P is either split or inert, and that can be detected by a direct characters, right? And that say that that one dimension representation of the Galois group correspond to the quadratic extensions, correspond to some automorphic form that is directly characters.
So I'm just wondering, this work on by Langlands on the groups, is there any generalization to Hopf algebras or
to
Hopf algebras?
To
Hopf algebras, yeah.
To Hopf algebra.
Yeah.
Oh, I think there is something that called quantum geometric Langlands program, but I'm afraid I'm not a specialist at that subject, but there is something that called quantum. And actually, it is quite, not so only people working on it, but it, I think it gets some real output into geometric Langlands, for example. Yes. I think Denis Gasgury now is making a lot of progress on geometric Langlands, and some of the ideas are borrowed from quantum geometric Langlands, and Hopf algebra do play a role. That is as much as I can say.
So I don't see any more questions. I would like to thank Ngô Bảo Châu again for his nice talk.